country has never cared about black people.
That's right.
They don't give two damns about us. And all of us always turn around worrying about what's good for America, what's good later for America, what's good for black people.
And I know what they're going to say, not guilty, because no one saw them pull the trigger. I'm tired of that. Don't bow down anymore. Hold your heads up. We want our freedom now. I don't want to have to go to another memorial. I'm tired of children. Tired of it. Got to stand up.
We must also realize that the problems of racial injustice and economic injustice cannot be solved without a radical redistribution of political and economic power.
If you can't do for yourself what the white man is doing for himself, don't say you're equal with the white man.
That's right.
If you can't set up a factory like he sets up a factory, don't talk that old equality talk.
Depression, depression. Stricken everywhere.
So much killing, stealing, and dying going on.
The man said it's saying, I ain't did no wrong. Taking out the leaders, one by one. Take away my livelihood, making me run. All this killing and misgiving.
Any black leader with charisma was a target of the government's COINTELPRO program. And that's stated in their own objectives of the program.
Who are you? You don't know. Don't tell me Negro, that's nothing. What were you before the white man named you a Negro? And where were you? And what did you have? What was yours? What language did you speak then? What was your name? It couldn't have been Smith or Jones. Or Bunch, or Powell, that wasn't your name. They don't have those kind of names where you and I came from. No, what was your name?
Yes, sir.
And why don't you now know what your name was then? Where did it go? Where did you lose it? Who took it? And how did he take it? What tongue did you speak? How did the man take your tongue? Where is your history? How did the man wipe out your history? How did the man, what did the man do to make you as dumb?
Yes, sir.
As you are right now.
To kill the brother because he had began to take meaningful steps towards gaining the freedom for his people. He was taking steps to internationalize the black man's struggle and to take it to the United Nations, to take it diplomatically to the other countries around the world, so that meaningful pressure could be brought to bear on the United States government and to force them to let his people go.
We can't prove for sure that the FBI COINTEL program or an agent of the FBI actually killed Malcolm X. They were certainly trying to reach that end. They were articulating that goal, and they were taking steps in furtherance of that, trying to cause the exact same thing to happen which happened. So we can step back from it and say, regardless of their success, whether they were the ones who pulled the trigger, this gives us an idea of what their intent was, what they were willing to do, what their political viewpoint was, and what ends and what unconstitutional and violent ends they were willing to adopt and use in order to reach their goal, which was to destroy progressive movements.
They, I want to say to the people of America and the nations of the world, that we are not about to turn around.
Yes, sir.
We are on the move now.
Yes, sir.
Yes, we are on the move, and no wave of racism can stop us.
Yes, sir.
And the burning of our churches will not deter us.
Yes, sir.
The bombing of our homes will not dissuade us.
Yes, sir.
The beating and killing of our clergymen and young people will not divert us.
Yes, sir.
The wanton release of their known murderers will not discourage us. We're on the move now.
Yes, sir.
So again, we cannot say for sure that James Earl Ray was working for the FBI. What we can say for sure is that the FBI had an intent shown by their programs against Dr. King, showed by the document I talked about preventing the rise of messiahs like Dr. King, that they wanted that to happen, and that they had again taken very active steps to do that. So then when Dr. King is killed a month after this document comes out, and after all of the attempts to get him to discredit him and to disrupt his organization, and in fact to have him do physical violence to himself and have others do physical violence to him, I mean, it becomes almost irrelevant whether they pulled the trigger or not. Because we know that they did pull the trigger on Fred Hampton.
We have to defend ourselves. We intend to defend ourselves. We did so in the past, and we're going to do it today, and the day after that, and the day after that. Because only through this proper example of the self-defense and the proper example of retaliation, and by letting these people know that we moved from some basic laws, that anything that goes down on oppressed people, on the part of the oppressor, it should be reciprocal. And in plain proletarian workers' language, it takes two to tango. As soon as these motherfuckers go, we go.
Fred Hampton was only 20 years old, but he had the ability to really move people, to speak in a way that got people going, that effectively seemed to energize them.
He was beginning to develop a following, you know, throughout the country, and he was a direct threat to the power structure that oppressed people.
People learn by example. I don't think anybody has an argument with that. I think that when Huey P. Newton said that people learn basically by observation and participation, I think that everybody caught on to that. So what we're saying very simply is that if they learn by observation and participation, that we need to do more acting than we need to do writing. And I think the Black Panther Party's doing that. That we didn't talk about a Breakfast for Children program, we've got one. We're not going to tell you how many kids we intend to feed and feed in Chicago. We're feeding 3,000 to 4,000 every week already, and I don't know how many all around the country. We're not talking about beginning to think about treating people free when they need medical services. We're opening a free health clinic in the city of Chicago in less than 3 weeks. These are the type of examples that people can relate to.
The immediate, violent, criminal reaction of the occupants in shooting at announced police officers emphasizes the extreme viciousness of the Black Panther Party. So does their refusal to cease firing at the police officers when urged to do so several times.
Ed Hanrahan, who was the political heir apparent of Mayor Daley, wanted to take credit for having killed this Black Panther leader. So he went on television, and explaining how Fred Hampton had come out of his bedroom firing a pistol, and how all the Panthers inside had repeatedly broken ceasefires and repeatedly fired at the police. The problem is, when you fire a bullet, two things happen. You have a shell that comes from your gun, and you have a bullet that comes out the other end. When the evidence was all gathered, it turned out that all the shells that were found in the apartment came from police weapons, with the possible exception of one. All the bullet holes, the directions of those bullet holes, were all coming inside from outside. That is, showed that they were fired by the police. So that all of the evidence that Hanrahan said, all the evidence that was gathered, proved that it was the police who fired, not the Panthers. Hanrahan went even further and actually pointed to places on the back door, which he said were evidence in pictures that the Panthers fired. The press themselves, when they looked closely at these pictures and returned to the scene, discovered that these were in fact nail heads and weren't bullet holes at all. The federal government at first appeared to be coming in and do a neutral investigation. And what the federal government did find, of course, was that it was the police and not the Panthers who had fired. Under their cover, though, the federal government, under the cover of appearing neutral, the federal government hid their own role, which was that it was their informant who had gotten a floor plan of the apartment, and their informant had given their floor plan to Ed Hanrahan's raiders.
I was supposed to be one of the murdered Panthers, okay? However, my plans changed that evening, and the informant, William O'Neill, was unaware of the change in plans that I had made. So my plans had changed, and I was not in the apartment. Mm-hmm. Oh, I was in the apartment earlier, but I left the apartment. And So I wasn't there. So they went to plan two in order to get rid of me. They raided my apartment the next morning on December 5th, shot my door down, and they thought that that I was in the apartment.
There had been a systematic effort by the FBI in Chicago and nationally to destroy the Panthers. Previously, the FBI in Chicago had sent a letter to the head of the El Rucans, Jeff Fort, telling him the Panthers were trying to assassinate him. Didn't he want to take some action to prevent that? They had deliberately attempted to provoke things between the Panthers and other groups and attempted to discredit the Panthers publicly.
They didn't have to kill every leader. All they had to do was kill one of the most important and up-and-coming and messianic leaders who was doing what Fred Hampton was doing, to send the message to all those young folks, whether they be black or white or Latin or whatever, who wanted to get involved in the struggle, that these are, this is the game that you're getting involved in. We'll kill you in your bed.
I think during different periods, the government uses different tactics, you know, and sometimes their methods will be to publicly discredit groups, to jail people. We saw that. Sometimes with regard to the Wobblies, they actually did kill people. We saw with regard to the Communist Party, they frequently would jail people or attempt to ruin their reputations. I think with regard to the black movement in particular, the escalation of the government's attacks was very clear. And I think assassination, setting people up for internecine rivalries which could lead to deaths, I think the government has shown a willingness to use any form of violence that it felt was necessary.
What are we fighting for? The love of freedom calls, and we've got to win. Depression, in the air. Depression, everywhere.
The FBI itself, its structure, was one which was never, of course, happy with the struggle. The fact that Martin Luther King was, phones were tapped, and the problems that J. Edgar Hoover gave him was clear. We only put King out. We expected it from us and SNCC, but certainly King was not a flaming revolutionary calling for the destruction of America. He was a reformist, trying to, in fact, improve America, and was good for the image of America.
Within the FBI, who viewed itself as the vanguard of fighting, you know, communism and so forth, they were always afraid that civil rights and the thrust for voting rights and so forth was, quote, a communist plot.
You take Martin Luther King, that is being led by communists all over this great country, feels that he has the key to the White House. He has the telephone call to the White House that can get anything he wanted.
I spoke for the white people. The white people rallied behind it, and we kicked the living hell out of the niggers, sent the out-of-town niggers to the hospital and out of the state, put back to their own hometowns where they ought to have been, and the niggers in St. Augustine got quiet and went back over to Niggertown where they belonged.
Our feeling was that the FBI agent from the South was indistinguishable from his community.
The FBI had to work with the local law enforcements. That were their task. So it was clear here, first of all, they have comradeship from being in the same type of job, law enforcement agencies, and they were comrades from being in the South there together, not having too much work, joking together, and probably had social life together. And since the local police were the enemies, were our enemies, and the FBI was supposed to be our allies, it meant an automatic split between them, which never occurred.
Well, I've just gotten through a couple of weeks ago with a 45 or 46-day battle of Ingram Park, I call it. That's the park there in Birmingham where we stopped Martin Luther King. And I mean, ladies and gentlemen, we had that nigger whipped.
FBI in the South, rather than stopping Klan violence, would in fact allow it to happen.
Mr. Schwartz. But that was the problem with the Birmingham Police Department. What about the FBI? Did you ever discuss with them why they didn't do anything? Mr. Rowe. Yes, sir. I was told by the FBI. They said, well, who the hell are we going to report it to? The police department was involved in it. The police department helped set it up. We are an investigating agency, not an enforcement agency. All we do is gather information. This was my answer. Mr. Schwartz. Mr. Rowe, were you an informant in the Klan? Mr. Rowe. Yes, I was. Schwartz. From when to when? Rowe. From approximately 1959 to 1965. Schwartz. In 1965, did you surface in connection with the murder case? Rowe. Yes, I did. Schwartz. Whose murder and what role did you play in that case? Rowe. I was in the automobile the evening that Mrs. Viola Luiso was killed by a Klansman.
At the high point of FBI involvement with the Klan, one out of four Klansmen was an FBI agent. So a lot, if not all, of Ku Klux Klan policy and actions were being directed by or acquiesced in by the FBI. And this led to the FBI and its COINTELPRO program and its other racially oriented programs actually being implicated in and instigating crimes, civil rights crimes, murders and such things. The Birmingham church bombing, the assassination of the civil rights workers, the Freedom Riders, Viola Luiso, for one, the people in Philadelphia, Mississippi. That Rowe was involved in all of this, and he was an FBI informant. He's the one who pulled the trigger, or at least fired a shot in one of the incidents. He was involved in the bombing, and again, connected to the FBI.
Hoover always felt that civil rights was a threat to the country. Not threat to the country, I don't believe he was a threat to the social order, to the order of things, and therefore as the protector of not only, quote, the country, which he didn't believe that we were part of, but the order of things, which he knew we weren't a part of, anything that threatened the order of things, he had a right to use tactics to destroy it.
There was a explanation for why our housing was bad, our education was poor, our political power was limited, and that explanation was that we were held as colonial subjects within the United States. It's not a perfect explanation. It's an analogy to situations in Africa and in Asia that we could see that fit us. Therefore, colonialism had been denounced by the United Nations, and people were entitled to their independence, and they were justified in breaking out of that type of control. That was the basic American history.
Police in our community couldn't possibly be there to protect our property because we own no property. They couldn't possibly be there to see that we receive the due process of law for the simple reason that the police themselves deny us the due process of law. And so it's very apparent that the police only in our community, not for our security, but the security of the business owners in the community, and also to see that the status quo is kept intact.
Police brutality remains as a major issue in the black community, and I'm sure in cities across the country. And probably will remain, because if you just examine what the police department is, it is the military arm of the establishment. So what do you expect of it? You expect it to protect the interests of the establishment.
When you talk about law and order, the very law and order that you talk about oppresses us. So therefore, we are for the extermination of that law and order. And you have shown us clearly that we can only do it by being armed.
The existentialist philosophers talk about the executioner-victim relationship that is always prevalent in most of the world today, especially the non-white world, where they're fighting for their liberation. He says there are executioners and their victims. The executioners are self-imposed. The victims begin to fight and agitate for their liberation. They use all type of means to get their liberation. The revolutionary philosopher Frantz Fanon says that what happens is that the victim begins to agitate. He uses all types of means against his executioner in fighting for a position of equality. After he tries a number of means and they do not work, he then begins to imitate the means by which his executioner kept him down. That is usually through force and violence. He says, and then they begin to use it against them, breaking the one taboo that they've never been able to break, hitting back against their executioners, so that you ought not to be upset. If we are violent, the United States taught us very well how to be violent.
Four days of rioting, looting, and arson rocked the city of Detroit in the worst outbreak of urban racial violence this year. Entire blocks of homes become infernos. At least 36 are killed, more than 2,000 injured, and damage topped the half-billion mark. Governor Romney declares a state of emergency, requests federal troops, and 5,000 paratroopers reinforce the National Guard, state and city police. The city's industry and business are severely affected, and a tight curfew is ordered in the Motor Center. A besieged city of guerrilla warfare. Sniper groups use day and night hit-and-run tactics before tanks move in to curb their window and rooftop barrage. Wreckage is everywhere. Civil rights leaders make a joint condemnation of the violence and call for an end to the rioting. President Johnson, using firm words, urges the nation's citizens to support the maintenance of law and order.
I know that the vast majority of Negroes and whites are shocked and are outraged by this. Pillage, looting, murder, and arson have nothing to do with civil rights. They are criminal conduct. Your president calls upon all of our people in all of our cities to join in a determined program to maintain law and order, to condemn and to combat lawlessness in all of its forms, and firmly to show by word and by deed that riots, looting, and public disorder will just not be tolerated.
When they take care of the reasons, not only will they eliminate this one, but all others that will come about.
I don't think it's over. I think it lasts until people understand what's going on. I know a lot of people, see? I know a lot of friends, but I know it's going to be tonight, it's going to be tomorrow night, and it's going to be until people straighten this up.
I know when this first happened.
When black people begin to rebel, and you'd call it riots, we understand that those are not riots, those are rebellions. People are rebelling because of conditions and not because of individuals. No individual creates a rebellion. It's created out of the conditions. And those rebellions will continue. And it's not a long, hot summer. That's white journalistic sensationalism. There's no such thing as a long, hot summer. I know some places around that, snow won't even touch the ground.
Black power is a consequence of the white backlash. Riots are consequences of the white backlash rather than a cause from it.
If they're trying to present themselves as a democratic nation, as a free nation, trying to get Africans under their wing, and Africans in America are under revolt and they're crushing them, it will cause too many problems. But J. Edgar Hoover was not a fool. He understood his job. He had to crush this movement. That's why COINTELPRO was not only instituted, was also quiet, because this one could not get out, because it was aimed really just at us.
He was prepared to try to destroy anything he saw as disruptive to the social order of things. That he saw, in the early days, the mob as the image of the G-men against the mob and so forth. And then later in terms of counterintelligence against foreign agents. And now in the 60s, something that he didn't understand, the civil rights movement disrupting the social order of things, you use the same kind of tactics that you use against the mob and the people, foreign agents, as to citizens of the United States that who were trying to get, their civil rights and their civil liberties, because they were all threats to the social order. And therefore, COINTELPRO came into being, and he thought he had basically God on his side.
Black power means goodness day.
means we're going to walk side by side with you or through you. We're going to be with dignity and integrity. We don't want any more than you have, and we're not going to accept any less than you have.
We will define black power. He will listen and recognize it. That's all. That's all.
We are now moving from a mere civil rights movement into a movement to gain political power to help deliver on the promises of civil rights. And the combination of the two words, black and power, was a little bit too much for white America to handle. What you have is with the black power movement is an avowed, consciously perpetrated statement that is political that says we want something more than simply the civil rights kinds of articulated demands. We want to talk about real power. We want to talk about international issues. We want to link all of this up. We're talking about political power, economic power, the internationalization of the movement.
It is time for an honest look at the problem of order in the United States. Dissent is a necessary ingredient of change. But in a system of government that provides for peaceful change, there is no cause that justifies resort to violence. Let us recognize that the first civil right of every American is to be free from domestic violence. So I pledge to you, we shall have order in the United States.
We were engaged in clearly a war of survival, a war of for self-determination, a war for economic freedom, a war for cultural freedom to be able to learn things of our culture, to regain our historical identity.
We have seen the terrible results of violence in this country. It would be intolerable if a handful of violent people, and that is what it is, just a handful, could harden us against needed change. We must give notice to this violent few. There are millions of decent Americans who are willing to sacrifice for change, but they want to do it without being threatened, and they want to do it peacefully. They are the nonviolent majority, black and white, who are for change without violence. These are the people whose voice I want to be.
The question of whether or not violence is going to be used is not a question for the black community. It's a question for white America. Because white America is the one who's used violence. For 400 years, we have been the recipients of violence. We have never lynched, we have never shot, we've never burnt a church, we've never beaten people, we've never taken them to jail. That is the question for white America. The real question is, can she civilize herself before we get ready to civilize her?
So at this particular time in Chicago, I'm going down 55th on Prairie, and I see the helicopter, I get out the car, and I'm looking, and some other people were looking too. And I look down and I see the cops, they were all burly white cops, this is like in the ghetto area, and they own this young brother who's on the ground, and I notice some other people around. But it's hard even to recall all that because my mind began to really, you know, it was like the whole thing changed. I saw Vietnam, I saw Bong San, Play Cool, Kantung, all of these places I had been at, you know, Bambatui, July, Coochie or whatever. And they all began to, like, metamorphosize in, almost in my mind. And I heard the cop talk in terms of detainee. And then later on in Los Angeles and then in New York, I heard that again. They had begun to even use the language. And so that brought home a lot of reality to me in identifying the brother on the ground with the Vietnamese or the Viet Cong, in which we had just got through doing that too. And the helicopters, almost the identical thing, but now we were the VC.
In America, black people are treated very much as the Vietnamese people or any other colonized people because we're used, we're brutalized, the police in our community occupy our area, our community, as a foreign troop occupies territory.
And we're just not concerned about the Vietnam War per se. We are concerned about the survival of black people in this country, and that we cannot survive if we go fight some yellow man in Vietnam who ain't never called us nigger.
No man can speak for Negroes who tells Negroes to suffer peacefully. There is no Negro in his right mind today who is going to turn the other cheek.
Now, they felt that by murdering Malcolm X that they would also kill his ideas. But I'm here to tell you that Malcolm X's ideas would be stronger now than they were when he was alive.
We want freedom. We want the power to determine the destiny of our black communities. We want full employment for our people. We want an end to the robbery by the capitalists of our black community. We want decent housing, fit for shelter for human beings. We want education for our people that exposes the true nature of this decadent American society. We want education that teaches us our true history and our role in the present day society. We want all black men exempt from military service. And we want immediate end to police brutality and murder of black people. We want freedom for all black men held in federal, state, county, and city prisons and jails. We want all black people, when brought to trial, to be tried by a jury of their peer group. Our people from their black communities, as defined by the Constitution of the United States. We want land, bread, housing, education, clothing, justice, and peace.
Because the Panthers captured the imagination and the energy of young black people in the cities, I think that they represented a real possibility or a potential for community control. I think that the government had, you know, we saw the riots that occurred after Martin Luther King was assassinated in 1968, and I think this government saw that within its own population there was a potential for a real rebellion. And I think the fact that the Panthers, the idea that the Panthers might lead such a rebellion and was a real threat, particularly when the United States was trying to wage a war in Vietnam and trying to use black soldiers, by and large, to wage the war.
They wanted to dismiss us as being a street gang. Well, we certainly were not a street gang. The threat was that we were a group of young people who were committed to organize into a political power base. Mm-hmm. The poor and oppressed people throughout this country.
When you live in a class society, the upper classes, they're in constant fear of the what they call the lower classes.
The Panthers wanted to explode the myth of the docile black who would turn the other cheek and say, no, we won't turn the other cheek. As a matter of fact, if you try to shoot me, I'm gonna shoot back, and if you got your gun, I got mine, and so therefore, if you wanted to aggress upon me, then whereas I'm not a natural and an aggressor, that I would defend myself to the hilt. And that's what we were attempting to do.
Well, actually, the Black Panther Party in total was a very American phenomenon. It was very similar analytically to the Minutemen, historically, a group of local citizens who rose up to defend their community against aggression, which is what the Black Panther Party conceived itself as, defending the community that blacks lived in from aggression from police forces who were hostile.
We said move to a higher level. We're moving to a level whereby the people are going to take over control of their destiny. They're going to take over control of their community. And the first way of doing this is dealing with the most integral part of the fascist three-way oppression. We said demagogic lying politicians and avaricious greedy businessmen, and we say fascist pig cops. But the one that's most evident, the one that's closest, the one that's more clear, the one that's more defined in the black community is those fascist pig cops. So what we're saying is, if the people can deal with these fools, then we would have taken a revolutionary step. A revolutionary leap, I should say. So that's the program that we think is going to move things to a high level. It's going to raise some contradictions. It's going to cause some antagonistic contradictions. We're prepared to deal with them, and we think the people are prepared to deal with them.
We constantly and at all times criticized and condemned racism. We always worked with other organizations. We never used color as the basis of our criticism. We talked about power to the people. And that was very fundamental. That is what essentially democracy is supposed to be about. But the media wanted to portray the Black Panther Party as something that white people would be afraid of. Therefore, it portrayed it as a all-black organization that hated white people and wanted to use violence against white people. But once you have that idea of an organization, then anything they say is bad. And anything that can be done to them is okay.
Well, you see, the media has played its traditional role. The white-owned, white-controlled media has played its traditional role back then and today. And their traditional role is to maintain the status quo. Status quo meaning white folks on top, black people on the bottom. So the media did the interpreting of what was going on. And they interpreted everything in the light of how it would impact upon the maintenance of the status quo. Still do it.
So you can see that there is a correlation between the type of illegal and subversive COINTELPRO actions that the FBI wanted to mount against the party and the image that was created in the media of the party. It's okay to do these things to a group of bad guys.
The slave master never liked the slave to get in a defensive position. He's called an upper nigger and he's lynched. But when you begin to study ways in which to thwart this genocide, these genocidal wars, and come up with ideas, logical ideas, ideas that will work, then you become the greatest threat to the internal security of the United States. And if that organization is the greatest threat, then this militant, military apparatus is up for grabs. It's fair game. All is fair in war and love and war. So you get a COINTELPRO, a completely illegitimate thing, and it's thrown at you. And you say, well, you can't cry. You know this is a war.
And that program was intended to be run secretly. It was intended to be run as a counterintelligence program would be run against, say, Soviet spies, that you spread false information about and among the black groups so that they would shoot each other.
Well, in California, there was a rivalry between the Black Panthers and a group called U.S. United Slaves. And documents now show that that materials were sent and information given to the United Slaves in an effort to get them to make an attack on the Panthers. And in fact, there was an attack made and two Panthers were killed.
The FBI would get hotel stationery, type a letter saying that Connie had met with Huey and David and they were really hostile toward Eldridge and he should be very careful about how he deals with them. And it would be, the signature would be C. Then Connie would get back to Algiers and tell us about her meeting. We already had this letter. And then she'd say, but I didn't send you that letter. So then we'd say, oh, she's lying.
In one situation, the FBI used a fugitive named George Sams, and they chased him across the country. And they would raid each Panther office just as he left. But they would use his supposed presence there as an excuse.
So the government made it very crucial to their success that it look as if these things just happened by accident. There was no connection between the plan of the FBI and the fact that so many Panthers were arrested, so many of them went to trial, so many of them marriages broke up, so many terrible things happened. However, when these things are happening to you, you know it's not an accident. You know it's not random. We knew at the time there was a conspiracy. We knew it was planned. We knew it was coordinated. We just had no idea how sophisticated the plan or how sophisticated the coordination was and or the collaboration between the various agencies. We didn't know it was called COINTELPRO, that involved the Department of Defense, it involved the White House, it involved the CIA and the FBI in coordination. We didn't know all that, but we knew they were doing these things against us. They were doing them deliberately, and we knew that they were wrong.
They were able to put a cover on the movement as best as they saw fit through COINTELPRO, and the best way was to keep it quiet. Even today, don't talk about it, because it still exists.
And what happened, it just went like this. No political, no politics. Next thing I know, I'm convicted of murder.
They knew that they had this unsolved murder. And what we were told was that if, in fact, Pratt was not convicted in the shootout trial, which, in fact, he wasn't, then they had to come up with something else. They weren't going to let him out of jail.
And like I said, I hadn't thought much of it because I was charged with the Tate LaBlanca murders before Charles Manson was charged with it. You know, because they had Off the Pig on the wall in blood. They picked me up for that before they even suspected Charles Manson. That'll give you an idea of how often I would be picked up and detained.
At the time the tennis court murder occurred, I remember that Pratt came into the Bay Area, that he and Bobby Seale, David Hilliard, came over to the place I was staying in San Francisco. We met one evening. The next day, and the next 2 days, there were meetings at David Hilliard's house in Oakland, and he was there all the time.
No matter what he did in 1968 or 69 as a Black Panther, he was arrested and charged with a murder. He went to trial, and he didn't know the following things. Neither he nor the defense attorney knew that the FBI was communicating daily with the LA Police Department to try to get him arrested and convicted of some kind of offense.
The fact that the government was spying on us meant that they would watch all of us. It's not a matter of only Pratt. They were watching Bobby Seale. They were watching David Hilliard. They were watching me. They would follow us. They knew where we went. They would tap our phones so that if all of us come to one house and have meetings for 2 days, they're going to know this.
Nobody knew that the chief witness against him was also an FBI informant threatened by the FBI with a machine gun charge. Butler was out on parole at that time, or on probation. He was alleged to have had a machine gun. The FBI could have locked him up for 5 years if they'd wanted to. So all of the circumstances were set to create a witness against Pratt who would cooperate rather than go to jail himself.
By the time his case came to trial, the party had been divided. So you could say that as a consequence of COINTELPRO insinuations, COINTELPRO actions, COINTELPRO desires, COINTELPRO goals had been accomplished in the sense that the party was split. And Geronimo's trial, Geronimo's destruction, you might say, was a consequence of that kind of activity because he could not, other than me, get anyone to testify where he was.
I had been telling them all along, the lawyers, and speaking in open court, trying to make these assertions, and they were looking at me like I was ego tripping. That would be the thing I would get back a lot. Niggas ego tripping. And the FBI didn't have nothing, they didn't care nothing. And so I would cry. I'm in Folsom Prison in a hole. I'm in a hole here. The communication weren't that they're good. So I tried the best I could. I wrote different people, and to try to expose what I knew, and I knew was the FBI involvement.
Pratt didn't know that one of the witnesses had identified somebody else as the murderer a year earlier against him. That didn't come out. He didn't know that the FBI had put informants in his defense camp that were reporting back to the FBI what Pratt and his attorneys were planning and talking about. Clearly, that's a constitutional breach. The FBI, of course, says, well, none of these things really affected his trial. That was just the evidence against him. But the FBI wouldn't release these documents. It took Pratt's attorneys, volunteer, acting pro bono without fee, from 76 until 1979 to drag out of the FBI grudgingly documents that still were heavily censored. You couldn't get certain information because they blacked it out. Finally, when all of the information that could be obtained from the FBI under the Freedom of Information Act was obtained, Pratt goes to the California court and then up to the Court of Appeal and finally to the Supreme Court. And during that process, in 79 and 1980, the FBI said to the state authorities, well, we're telling you all about COINTELPRO and everything we can find, but deliberately kept from the California Attorney General and the court the information that one of their own agents thought Pratt had been framed by the FBI in 1972.
So it's a very political situation. Very political, and it should have never been really handled. The courts are not equipped to handle a case of this magnitude. It should have been handled on an international level, you know. And this is where we've been petitioning more and more and more. In fact, I was invited to speak in Geneva representing political prisoners in this country just last month. But there are difficulties with that, you know. That it should be handled on an international, broader level where people can understand, because you're like asking Jesse James to adjudicate what his brother Frank James did. It's not easy.
In spite of the fact that J. Edgar Hoover is no longer with us, we have some J. Edgar Hoover types. And they do what they can to make sure that the opportunity for self-expression is denied.
And the fact of the matter is that in America, like in every other society, that it's prepared to tolerate injustice in order to maintain the social order. Yes,
this is American justice.
Yes, that's right.
This is American democracy.
Yes, right.
And those of you who are familiar with it,
yes,
know that in America, democracy is hypocrisy.
Right.
Now, if I'm wrong, put me in jail.
Right.
But if you can't prove that a democracy is not hypocrisy, then don't put your hands on me.
Right.
Democracy is hypocrisy.
Right.
If democracy means freedom, why aren't our people free?
Right.
If democracy means justice, why don't we have justice?
Right.
If democracy means equality, why don't we have equality?
Depression, depression.